But my inner super spy instincts knew that I had to make his dream vanish quicker than Molly's in a maths test. And when we got to Charlie's house, I broke the news that the sleepover was to remain a shark-free zone. Why? He asked. Eric turning into a shark, Molly turning invisible. We have to keep these things top secret. You of all people know that. What's Zach Danger's number one rule about secrets? I asked, knowing full well that any true Zach Danger fan would know this. Secrets aren't secret if you don't keep them secret, he sighed, quoting Zach Danger and the secret traitor word for word. Exactly. We need to keep this information to ourselves, just the Danger Gang. So no liquids are to be consumed around Eric tonight. And Molly needs to promise to stay visible the whole time, I said. As if my new rules for Charlie's sleepover weren't bad enough, the moment we stepped into Charlie's house, Mr. and Mrs. Campbell handed out a sheet of their own sleepover rules that they'd even had laminated in plastic to make them indestructible, which is a terrible way to start any party. No TV, no rock, rap, dance music, only pop. No jumping on sofa, bed, or each other. No fun. Someone should tell grown-ups that decorating rules with glittery stars does not make them any less lame. Once Mr. and Mrs. Campbell had disappeared into the kitchen, I quickly scribbled my own Danger Gang rules at the bottom. No drinking around Eric. No turning invisible. And explained the whole secrets aren't secrets unless we keep them secret thing. And we all made a Danger Gang promise. So a few minutes later, there we were, sitting on Charlie's living room floor, playing Pass the Parcel like a bunch of five-year-olds, listening to music by some ancient band that the grown-ups seemed to like, that I'd never heard of anyway. McFly. There was a huge sigh of relief when Charlie's dad said, "Present time!" Now here's the thing. Remember I told you that Charlie is animal mad? Well, for almost as long as the Danger Gang has existed, Charlie has been banging on about how he's going to get a pet for his birthday, but he doesn't know what sort of animal it is. It's a surprise, so we've all been guessing. A venomous snake, a scary Rottweiler, a monkey, a bird-eating spider, an alligator, two alligators. Okay, so some of our guesses were a bit out there, but it was Charlie, and he was obsessed with those kinds of bitey, stingy, deadly animals. So it was pretty exciting waiting to see which super awesome animal Charlie was going to be calling his pet as we gathered around to watch him open his presents. The first boxes contained the usual stuff, pyjamas, a new lunchbox. To be honest, it was a total snore fest until his dad brought out the final present. I don't know why parents always leave the best present until last. When did they all get together and decide to do this? It's like leaving your favourite bit of dinner until the end. By the time you get to it, you're so full up of presents that you can't eat anymore. Wait, why am I talking about eating presents? You know what I mean. Anyway, Charlie's dad carried his last present out in a special box with holes in the top, and we all knew that could only mean one thing. There was something alive inside. Charlie tore open the box with an enormous smile on his face. Was it a deadly venomous snake? The world's most stingy jellyfish? A baby alligator that he could train to bite his enemies in the playground. Charlie reached inside and we all stepped back as he pulled out the fluffiest furball any of us had ever seen. A hamster! What a letdown. All those precious minutes we'd spent imagining our friend owning some sort of awesome creature from the jungle or the depths of a swamp, and it turned out to be a ball of fur from Freaky Pets, the pet shop at the end of our road. On the other hand, it was at least four times fluffier than a regular hamster, and it had bright green eyes. "What kind of hamster is it, Mr. Campbell? I've never seen one like this," asked Katie, who knew loads about hamsters because she had two of her own. Well, the man at the pet store wasn't quite sure himself. You see, these hamsters just appeared in his shop the other month, as if by magic. He had no clue where they came from, Mr. Campbell explained. "What do you mean he didn't know where one of his hamsters was pregnant and had hamster babies in the night?" Katie asked. "No, it's the strangest story. He told me that he'd sold all his hamsters that day and the cages were empty when he locked up in the evening. There was a big lightning storm later, so he came in early to check on the animals, and when he opened up, he found a cage of these fluffy little things." Well, I bet you're thinking that my heart pounded in my chest when he mentioned the lightning storm, and you're right.